In spite of the impending devastation which the Channel Tunnel is inevitably going to bring to an important stretch of the Kent countryside, there's an area just to the east of Dover which is as fine and dramatic and unharmed as any part of the English coastline. Take the steep road past mighty Dover Castle and then travel along the White Cliffs to St Margaret's Bay and on to Kingsdown and Walmer. Don't walk too close to the edge because there's no protecting fence, but here you will find air as invigorating as any in the land, views as uplifting, turf as springy, sea and skyscapes as spectacular. These glorious white cliffs put to shame much of the rest of the Kent coastline, and long may they continue to dazzle and welcome visitors from the continent to this country, and to fill with nostalgia from afar those returning home after a long absence. As the gulls dive and swoop behind an autumn plough, their white feathers are dulled by the gleaming chalk of the cliffs. Hundreds of feet below, the waves look like ripples on a duck pond, and out at sea, boats and ships of all shapes and sizes cross and weave in this most dangerous of waterways. It's hard to understand how they ever manage to avoid one another. Not for nothing is this described as the most perilous sea lane in the world. Lighthouses have played a vital role along this part of the Kent coast for centuries. John Blanche takes care of a cliffside garden which surrounds the old lighthouse just above St Margaret's Bay. But his main job is to look after and maintain the nearby South Foreland Lighthouse, which beams its warning light out towards the treacherous Goodwin Sands.
I've worked at South Foreland Lighthouse here for now 20 years, and it's been a very good job, and it's only broke down once in that 20 years. Well, I had to use the weights for one night. And it was all right because a lot of friends from the village that I know fetched me a lot of beer that night and kept me quite happy, they did. And it's a very good job. And the area around here is very nice. The people are very friendly. Mainly it's keep it clean, change the lamps when they burst down, or if there's an emergency come up, like the weights, you know, the engine getting... the electric getting cut off, and then I have to come and start up the generator, and then I have to check it every so often and make sure that it's working right. It could be a lonely job, but this is not out at sea, and it's a land-based one, so it's easier to get to the village. It's only about 5 minutes walk from here to the village, so I can quite comfortably get there and have me pint at night and do me shopping and that, and it's quite good. There's days here you can look out across that sea there, and some days you can't see a ship, another day it's full of ships. Or it's thick fog, it changes so rapidly around here. Oh, it's blowy, you know, you get the bad weather, but we've managed every night to get out for our pint, and that's all that matters. No, I like this place. I want to be buried in this sort of area because it's very nice. I like it.
And soon I learned the word.
Many a fishing boat has been saved by the warning lights along this precipitous shore. Today, most of the local fishermen work off the steep shingle beach at Walmer, just to the east of the White Cliffs. It's hard and dangerous work, and in October, when the weather allows, Dave Harris and his son are out after cod and lobster and the last of the valuable sea bass.
Dave, is fishing in the blood?
No. Might be now. It wasn't originally, but I think it is now. Once you work for a year, I don't think you'll ever leave the fishing after that. No, I wasn't born to it. I'm the first one in my family that have taken it up. I was a builder first. Went to Scotland on holiday, see the fishing, and that was it. Come back, bought a boat, didn't know much about it. It is a dangerous occupation. Supposed to be 10 times more dangerous than a coal miner. It is dangerous.
How about lobsters? As I thought they'd all gone long since.
No, it's put down to good farming. We could work twice as much gear, twice as many pots on the ground, but you'd only catch half as much. It's, as I was saying, like a farmer, really. There's just about enough sheep in that field to make the grass grow. Nets we shot away at 6 o'clock this morning, and they're there only on slack water because that's the only time they fish. And the cod are that size because that's the size at the moment we're working on the mesh. As they get larger, we increase the mesh size up and let the smaller ones through. It has been an exceptional catch today, and it is a good cod year. Simple as that, really. Last year it was all smaller fish, which we don't usually net for. So last year wasn't a good, and now they've got that much bigger and they're a nice fillet in size. And now, next year, they'll be that much bigger again. Our nets are now lifted, and they've not damaged the seabed whatsoever. All the immature fish have gone through the net because of the size mesh we work. And now, here we are, they've got another 12 hours before we add them again.
The sun may shine on fishermen and lighthouse keepers, but not, apparently, on farm workers. Like his father and grandfather before him, Chris Collins is a shepherd. Sheep are in his blood, and he has an instinctive wisdom about them. Now that he has retired, Chris still lives on the Waldershare estate where he once looked after thousands of sheep, and he has time to cultivate his garden. He still keeps a few sheep for old time's sake, and with the help of his wife and assistant shepherd Dorothy, he takes as much care of them as ever he did of the mast flocks in the old days.
Well, we do get some bad weather on this coast. It's awful today, and so we get used to it. I've been in sheep for 52 years. Grandfather and my father before me, anyway. I was assistant shepherd to my father for a good many years. Then my father retired, and then we wanted another assistant. So we didn't know who to find, so we found my wife. And being a farmer's daughter, she knew a bit about animals, so she came along with me for right up till I retired. Yes, yeah, she's a good shepherd. Semi-retired, anyway. Oh, it's my hobby now. I think I like to see the poo. Oh, it's changed a lot. I mean, we had thousands of sheep here when I first come here. There's 8 shepherds, and under shepherds. Now, we're down to south. I mean, through the war times, we went over to Arable, and the sheep went. Now we've only got a small flock. Yeah, we have different twice a year, probably July and October. That's going to scab. I wouldn't go to another county. I've been in this county all my life, and I know the county, and I know the sheep. Oh, I'd still like to have a big flock now. But time passes on, so what you got to do?
At first sight, fox hunting close to the White Cliffs of Dover seems a dangerous idea. Yet the West Street Hunt meets regularly at St Margaret's at Cliff, and finds foxes that do not seem bent on leading horses and hounds too close to the nearby white precipices. Les Atkinson is the third generation of his family to be a huntsman, and he has hunted up and down the country. Now, he has settled in southern Kent and is pleased with what he has found there.
Today is at St Margaret's Bay. It's a little confined, but a very, very, very great atmosphere with the farmers down this way. That's why we come down here.
But I think probably to start with, we'd be better off going up to Mr Lyon's kennel, yeah. And as the first draw, and then we'll go on to Oxney, which we haven't been to this season.
I brought 15 and a half couple of hounds out today, 2 and a half couple of young hounds, and the art of coming out today really is just to enter the young puppies into the pack. Mm-hmm.